Hello, Fit Fam. Coach RJ here, and today I want you to get to know your fat. And what I've done is I've brought on an expert, home health NP. We got Marvin DeCastro in the house. Marvin, thank you for joining us. So, Marvin, just to give everybody a little bit of validation, why I brought you on the show here. What is it that you do in a nutshell?
So I'm a nurse practitioner, and I have a business called Home Health NP. And we try to provide healthcare services that are easy for clients. So we do home visits. We also do like phone visits and virtual care. We also have a clinic for patients that can go to.
So whenever I have any major health questions, I don't really have any like doctor friends that I just kind of sit around and chat with. You and I, we have multiple conversations through even just Facebook, right?
Yeah,
and it's
absolutely.
Sometimes it's that easy versus having to call, get on a health line, wait a couple hours or go to the MR or whatever. And you know, in the merge and
yeah,
right. My wife's got a rash. Right. And
yeah,
so she's like, I got to get a hold of Marvin.
Yeah,
like it's like
absolutely.
That. Right. So,
yeah.
So I want to bring you on just to maybe get a little bit of the medical side into it, because I do a lot of research into this, but I'd like to get more of the medical side and some of the research that maybe you've put in or through the schooling that you had. And so I want to start off with this first slide. And if we can get my man, DJ Sinigang, to pull that up. It's up. Here we go. Hold on. So in this first slide, what it is everybody that's starting off. And the nice thing about coronavirus, I know it's not like a nice thing, but
yeah,
I see it as a reset, restart. And so a lot of people had to really step back and they had to start from the beginning,
mm-hmm,
right? And some of us, I've only had a couple like restarts with my fitness when
yeah,
I fractured my knee.
Yeah.
I was still in good shape, but like I couldn't use my lower body.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like I did, but I couldn't. You know, and that's probably the one of the only other times that I've ever done that. And so some people have never really experienced any type of setbacks.
Yeah.
Right? And like you've done it, like you've played high sports, you've probably gotten injured, or
yeah,
you've taken time off from the gym and you restart, but it takes a strong mind to get back into
absolutely
it.
Absolutely.
And so this graph here shows you the way that your body and your life is going to go. And the one thing that I try to really get across to people that this is a lifestyle,
yeah,
right? You can't just be fit for 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Like you have to be fit forever. And it depends on how your goals are. It's going to change as your life changes.
Yeah.
So like you and I, we play basketball together. So back in our like, you know, teens and 20s, right? We probably didn't train much. Like
no,
we didn't actually like lift weights or anything. It wasn't famous then at that
yeah
time, right? So when we, back then, if we were to train, we would have trained for sport.
Yeah.
And then we probably trained a little bit more for physique.
Yeah.
Right? We want to
yeah
look good. We're single, right?
Yeah.
And then we train now just for our health, right?
Yeah.
We want to feel good. We want our clothes to fit better.
Yeah.
And so, but you got to keep working at it.
Yeah.
So the best thing you can do is continue to work on your nutrition and working out. The worst thing you can do is keep doing what you're doing. So for those out there with this brief moment of time where you had to pause, don't keep that pause going. So it's like if you fell off, the best thing you could do is jump back on,
mm-hmm,
right? And so if you keep coming up with an excuse as to what it is, you're always gonna find an excuse. The thing I like about you earlier is you're like, oh, you know, I'm so busy and this and that, but you know what? I'm just giving out my excuses.
Yeah,
and you're like, because then I know you're gonna jump on it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's kind of what everybody has to do. And so first, I just want to start with what the weight loss or transformation journey actually looks like with clients. And so when they originally start, the first thing, so let's take a 40-year-old woman, 45, whatever, that's generally the clients that come in here,
mm-hmm,
and they start working out, the first thing that they're going to notice is that their weight is the first thing to go.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now my theory on that, so I'm talking a woman could lose anywhere from 5, even up to 10 pounds in the first 4 weeks.
Yeah.
By just working out.
Mm-hmm.
And my theory on that is that the body doesn't want to carry around heavier weight than it has to.
Mm-hmm.
And so it makes adaptions to whatever the strain is, right? So if they're coming to Fit Club and they got to move around, do burpees, jumping jacks, that kind of stuff, the body doesn't want to have to work harder than it has to. And so the first thing it's going to do is it's going to make you lose that weight.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? So do you have any, like, is there any medical why that would happen? Or
yeah, you know what, you know, generally when even for males, so generally when you're at that age, you tend to carry on more different types of fat, right? Okay. So you might be a little bit heavier set. Maybe you might have something like a pot belly. And a lot of that is because your lifestyle is sedentary. So you're not working out. Mm-hmm. And so if that fat is not being utilized, it just keeps kind of piling on, right? So when you get into a program like yours where you're getting structured exercise, you're getting some accountability, and you're also integrating in a nutrition plan, it's really easy to lose those pounds because you're actually having something structured, and now your body is utilizing those fats properly, and it's burning through it, And so a lot of that is, like you alluded to earlier, it's lifestyle, and a lot of people don't have the motivation and they just don't have the guidance to be able to do that themselves. But when you start to have a commitment of exercising and a good diet every day of the week, you're gonna see those pounds come off naturally.
Yeah. Well, I've noticed, and if you could see this scale, the initial 3, maybe even up to 4 months for a new person is like weight loss, right? And it's pretty rapid. And so it's very motivating,
Absolutely.
It's like, you know, when you see that you're losing 1, 2 pounds, 3 pounds, 4 pounds every week, you're like, okay, this is great, this is working, I'm doing a great job. And then there gets to a point where your body's like, okay, hold on, right? And this is where the medical portion would come in. Person loses 12 to 15 pounds in 4 weeks or in 3 months, your body would probably go into some type of like shock. You know what I'm saying? Like if you start to lose too much weight, your body thinks that it's wasting away. Like it doesn't know that you're exercising and cutting calories to lose weight. Like there just isn't that connection. Is that, do you see that as being a true thing? Or
you know what I find with patients who lose a lot of weight dramatically, I find actually they feel better. They feel like they have more energy. But the thing I stress is to develop a lifestyle that's sustainable, right? Because once you lose, say, 10 or 15 pounds, if you're on something like a crash diet, and there's a lot of fad diets out there, and then all of a sudden, and they're not sustainable, you're gonna gain all that weight back, and it's gonna come back even heavier. And so for a lot of patients, you're gonna see benefits the more weight that you lose. And I don't think that there's a big difference in terms of if you're losing it rapidly, you're gonna feel any more different than being more energetic.
I'm just thinking that as somebody loses weight rapidly like that, at some point in time, their body's going to stop losing weight, right? Like I've seen it all the time where it's like, you know, it's 4 pounds first month, 6 pounds second month, 7 pounds third month, 8 pounds fourth month, 8 pounds fifth month, 7 pounds, 5 pounds. Like, I mean, let's say you're 200 pounds. Like you can't, your body just can't lose 25% of the weight in 6 months. And so at some point in time, your body wants to find what's called a set point. And I've seen multiple set points change, right? Like you can recreate a set point. And so what it does is it's going to say, okay, hold on. This is where you're at. This is your activity levels. This is how you're eating. Without it making any other major drastic changes, this is where you're going to stay for a little while. Get used to it. Work on something else. You know what I mean? Like, don't focus strictly on that number. You hit that number, you've plateaued, you've been putting in all the work for these past 4 months. Now it's just chill out here. And that's where a lot of people panic, is when they hit that plateau, right? And then they hit that plateau, they stay consistent like you're talking about, and they do it consistently. And like you said, there's a bunch of fad diets. I think which diet works the best, any one of those fad diets that you can stick to. You know what I mean? And I've tried multiple fad diets in conjunction, right? But I have the discipline and the knowledge to do so. And I'll give you a perfect example. Monday, Tuesday, I'll go keto. And I carb time, meaning that Monday, Tuesday, I go low carb, but then my only carbs that I'll eat are generally in and around my workout. So that's carb timing. That's one fad diet. Then I'll do keto because that's low carb. So I'll do keto. I'm not, maybe not in keto, but it's still no carbs, and I go high fats. And so I do multiple fad diets throughout the week. And then I do glycogen depletion towards the end so I can get my big carb meal in. So what fad diet works? They all work. It's just, how do you structure it? The only fad diet that doesn't work is the, oh, I was on a diet for 12 hours or 2 days, and now I need to go back and start eating cake and pizza every day because I failed for one meal. You know,
you know, I would say that whatever diet that you're taking on, it's important that, again, it's sustainable. For people to turn around their diet, you know, to do a full 180 degrees and they're eating foods that are so foreign, it's a little bit harder. But when you, when I stress to the patients I follow, you know, implement little things at a time, because then you're going to see those habits change daily and you're going to adapt to it a lot easier. When you switch to some, and you know, there's nothing wrong with these fad diets as long as you can see that they're sustainable and that you're also monitoring your health, right? Things like intermittent fasting are you know, in the literature, there's tons of benefits, right? There's Mediterranean diets, DASH diets. And you're right, all those diets are going to be helpful. And it's better than doing no diet, I would say, right? Yeah. But it's giving you some structure. At least, right? Yeah.
It's just like working out. Well, which workout is the best? Obviously, Fit Club.
Absolutely. Yeah, obviously.
But on top of that, you know, it's whatever you can do that's sustainable. Some people, they love to run. Yeah. You know, and then how can we say, well, you know, run? No, you can't run. Like, that's what you do. You do it well. Go and run.
Yeah.
Me, you like to play basketball. I'd love to get out there.
Absolutely.
If I can build and get ripped like I do without, you know what I mean? And just play sports.
Yeah.
Then I could. But I know it won't happen. So I got to do the combination of the both. And they complement each other. And so whatever workout is working for you that you can do consistently and it's reaching you towards your goal, then that is what you need to do long term. And then you could try other things. And so, you know, the other day I had a couple women come in here and they did a workout. They didn't show up today. I'm super disappointed. So I'm going to send them a text message.
Yeah.
But they also threw a lot of fear and doubt into me because of the fact that the trigger questions for me, I don't know if you have the same with clients, is that when they come to you, how long is it going to take before I lose my fat around my stomach? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, are you like realistically asking me? Or are you asking me like you want it tomorrow? She's like, well, yeah, I want to know how fast. Like, can I just do this for a month? And I'm like, well, how long have you been inactive? Yeah. How long has that belly fat been sitting there?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, so you've been gaining 5 pounds every year for the past 5 years.
Yeah.
And you want me to lose those 25 pounds in 5 days?
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, I can't do that. And so I always try to set a realistic expectations with our clients. Mm-hmm. Is it possible to lose 10 pounds in a month? 100%. I've had a client that was consistently losing 10 to 15 pounds every day, but I know what she went through to get there, or every month. And I know what she did to get there. And so when you start asking those trigger questions and you want it now, it's like, no, you need to slow down. You need to adopt some behaviors. The second question is, well, what meal plan should I be on? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, well, why are you even like worried about a meal plan? So not only are we going to now get you into a new exercise routine where you're going to be sore, tired, probably a little bit grumpy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Now we're going to throw in a whole restricted diet where it's foods you're maybe not accustomed to, where you're going to be in a bit of a calorie deficit, where now you actually got to start planning your foods out. So now you've just added 6 layers of an onion to it.
Yeah.
So it's like, no. I said, you know what? Work out for 30 days, survive the 30 days, and then talk to me and we'll talk about your nutrition and we'll change one thing.
Yeah, that's right.
You know,
and I agree with that approach. I think it's mindset and it's preparing them that this is not, a quick weight loss program. This is going to be a lifetime, change, right? Mm-hmm. Because if you don't understand how the exercise and the nutrition fits into it, then you won't understand how you're going to lose weight, right? You can't just lose weight after a month and then all of a sudden go back to your regular lifestyle because you're going to gain all that weight back. And, you mentioned earlier about people getting tired around the 4 week mark after they've lost 12 or 15 pounds, but a lot of that is mental fatigue, right? Mm-hmm. You're working out like crazy. You've changed your diet drastically, and you're just and you see it with a lot of these workout videos is you start to plateau around that month. But that's the advantage with having coaches and nutritionists like you guys, because you're holding patients accountable. Because at that one 2 to 4 week mark when they finish their program, it's like, hey, are you going to continue? Is this something that you're going to sustain, right?
Yeah.
That's really what it's about. Sustainability, it's developing good, healthy, daily, habits, right?
Yeah, and if you find something that's working, don't switch it.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? You can go and challenge yourself in other ways. Like if you feel like you need a change, right? That's some of the questions that we get. But you can go and supplement this, right? Yeah. Like go and challenge yourself, go do a fun run, or you know, go play a sport. I always say, like, you really want to test your athleticism, go play a sport,
yeah,
right? Or go play some frisbee golf, or go for a run, or do something. Challenge yourself outside of this. This is your home base. This is what's got you to where you are.
Yeah.
Maintain that, boom, and then challenge yourself in other ways. And so after people have done their weight loss, so around 3 to 4 months is when they start to kind of like hit the peak of that, and then they plateau in and around like another 4 to 8 weeks, right? So it takes 2 weeks to really kind of create that new set point. They'll lose a little bit more weight because now their body's like, okay, mentally, physically, I know what I'm doing. I got it going, so let's keep this rolling. They'll lose a little bit more weight. Then after that, the numbers become like almost redundant.
Yeah.
Right. So we've had clients go from 199 down to 130, and it's like, well, you can't lose anymore.
Yeah.
There's no more weight to lose. Don't aim for 100 pounds.
Yeah.
You just, at this point now, you've gained muscle mass.
Absolutely.
Right. And so muscle is it's way more dense.
Yes.
Right. Like if you put a pound of muscle and a pound of fat in one spot, you'll see that the fat absorbs way more space, and then the fat is super dense, and so it weighs more. Right? And it's more metabolically active, and your body fat is going to shrink. So those are the numbers that start to change. But here's the problem, is that the reason why we have body fat is because it's used as storage.
Yeah.
So what is the main use of body fat?
So, well, body fat is, like what you said, it's storage. And your body utilizes fat as energy, right? So if you're sedentary or someone who doesn't exercise much or, you know, do much on a daily basis, the fat will just start to build up because your body is not utilizing any energy, right? You don't need energy if you're just lying there and watching like Netflix, right? But you start working out, then your body goes into like a deficit, and your body has to start using the fat that you've stored. And so that's the benefit with doing the exercise if you're not already exercising, and also adapting to a good diet. Because if you have a bad diet, and you know, I don't know what your personal take is, but I see diet and exercise 70% diet, 30% exercise, in terms of if you want to get a good weight loss, because really it's what you're putting into your body that makes a big difference.
Yeah, I think that they definitely go hand in hand. As for what the blend is, I don't know what the true blend is. I don't want people to use it as, oh yeah, it's all about my nutrition, so I'm not going to work out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because I've seen people that work, that just eat well.
Yeah.
And they just can't do anything. They couldn't lift this scale. They
couldn't,
you know what I mean? They have no functionality.
Both. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You need both.
I always say abs are made in the kitchen.
Yeah.
So what you eat.
Yeah.
But they're built in the gym.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, you're not going to have muscle if you don't lift.
Yeah.
If you don't exert yourself. And so I think that's a great point. And especially about the more active that you are, the more body fat that your body's going to utilize at rest.
Absolutely.
And so that body fat and the more muscle you have, the more calorie dependent it becomes. And so it'll start to reach into your fat stores. And you may not see a big drastic drop in body fat, but it's going to slowly come off. Whereas the average person, so research shows that the average person gains a pound of fat, right? And so it takes 3,500 calories in a surplus to gain 1 pound, okay? And so like this girl, this other day, I just did her measurement, she lost 8 pounds.
Yeah.
She's been here for 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And she's on the higher number. She was inactive, had a baby,
just
getting into it. Goes really hard,
like
harder than any like new person. We just did a transformational video on her.
Yeah.
And she, of course, I could see that. She hasn't changed her diet at all.
Yeah.
Right? And it's just because her body's in a deficit from working out. Now she's way more active. She moves around more. She feels better.
Yeah.
And so she's naturally into that deficit. But it can go the opposite direction. And a lot of people don't realize how easy these calories add up.
Yeah.
Right? So an average person, especially now, working from home, right? So you're working from home. So literally you go from bed, you don't even put clothes on anymore, and you go right to your computer.
Yeah.
Right? So you go from bed to your computer, you have your coffee, you have your breakfast, you know what I mean? Like you have all this food in front of you. And so when you take your break, what do? You walk over to the kitchen, you grab a little snack.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then it's like, it's lunchtime. So
I'm
tuned to eat lunch, right?
Yeah.
So I got to go eat my lunch. And so now you're like, oh, but you know what? I don't want to go home. I don't want to go to the gym. I don't want to work out. I can't do the virtual thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what we get. I don't want to go to the gym yet, right? Some people, they're waiting. Or I can't get into the virtual, so I'm going to do nothing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's like, okay, so now you're moving way less.
Yeah.
Right? So now you've decreased, because even you walking to your car, and then from your car, from your parking spot to your office, and then from walking from your office to the long hallway at your old office to go to the washroom, then walking back, and then walking. So you've decreased your steps by 50%. You're not going to the gym.
Probably more.
Yeah. Like everybody should get a watch monitor and figure out how many steps they're getting.
Yeah.
Decrease the amount of activity you're doing because you no longer go to the gym to get that high push threshold, plus the walking that you're doing from the gym and that.
Yeah.
And then you would go home and you'd probably be eating less because you don't have time.
Absolutely.
But now you're at home. What do you do? You have time because you're sitting around.
And you have access. You
right. Know, and so things
right
are only going to go like this.
Yeah.
And one of the problems that a lot of people don't understand is that as you get older, you know, when you were 20, I always call that fresh fat, right? So when we get the 18, 19-year-olds and their body fat is high, and then all of a sudden their body fat shrinks after 4 weeks, 8 weeks, they're like down 10% body fat.
Yeah.
Well, I'm like, well, that's that fresh fat.
Yeah.
Right? You got the old fat.
Yeah.
The fat that's been sitting in you for so long that's been caked up.
Yeah.
And so that's what leads to my next thing, okay? So the first question is that we use this body fat scale, okay? Now, it's not 100% accurate, Marvin. Mm. There's better ways that you can measure this, probably through visceral fat. What's some medical ways that you can measure visceral fat?
Well, first, let's talk about visceral fat. So you have two kinds of fat that shows on your body.
Okay.
One of them is subcutaneous fat. That's more of the fat that you can kind of pinch on your belly.
Okay.
You can get that in your thighs and everywhere else on your body. And then there's a visceral fat that's it's hidden into your abdominal cavity and it kind of surrounds your organs.
Mm-hmm.
And so in terms of like measuring visceral fat, we use things, we guesstimate. So we use things like measuring your body mass index. So that's taking a ratio of your height and weight. We take a waist circumference. And we also do a hip to waist ratio. And generally speaking, you know, the higher the numbers, the more heavier you are and the more visceral fat that you carry, like, you know, the dad bods or the pot bellies.
The standing stomach.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So that in general, you'll carry more visceral fat.
Okay.
There is one way to directly measure it, but it doesn't make sense in a medical standpoint to do it. But they do MRIs.
Okay.
And so they can see directly how where the visceral fat is located, and they can actually measure. But it doesn't make sense because it's so expensive.
Right.
And then so it's not routinely done.
Mm. Mm. Well, with the scale. So the way that this scale works, it's a bioimpedance.
Yeah.
So it's a small electrical shock. So they don't recommend it for anybody that's got metal implants.
Okay.
Or anybody that is pregnant.
Yeah.
Okay. Because it does send just a small impedance. So electricity, you don't feel it, doesn't shock you, nothing. And the nice thing about this one is that it has the hands and feet, right?
Yeah.
So it goes from the hands all the way down to the feet and back up. Now, fat is a bad conductor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if you look at, you put two big metal rods together, you put electricity from one side, it's gonna shoot out the other. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So that would be your muscle.
Yeah.
Now what happens with your body fat is that you put a rubber band in the middle, then you plug the two rods.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll conduct, but now it goes zzz, and it slows it down.
Yeah.
And so basically that's how this measures your body fat.
Yeah.
Now what it does is it goes in deep into your body. Not sure how it separates the visceral and the actual body fat itself, but it does give us the number of body fat and it does give us the number of the visceral fat. Now I'll tell you, I've been on this scale and it's accurately inaccurate, but it's both.
Yeah.
So if you're gonna pick one method, easy method to do it, this is the best because it's consistently. So it's gonna be consistently inaccurate, but it's gonna give you the same consistent inaccurate number.
Yeah. And, you know, I would,
does that make sense?
Yeah, and, you know, I would say that you know, you have something objective to measure, right?
Yeah.
You know, I like when you have programs structured like yours,
mm-hmm.
and you start off with, okay, you know, I've taken my weight, mm-hmm. I've taken my BMI, mm-hmm. I know what my visceral fat is, my body fat. And then when you start to see improvement over those weeks, then you can use that as a motivator and as a tool to reach goals, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some people, when they start to work out and they start to change their diet,
they
have no goal, but they just know they want to lose weight. But
yeah.
The only thing they're looking at is scale. Yeah, it's too general. So
scale
I like
even
that
general
you guys do
too.
That. Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, whenever somebody comes in here, we actually haven't used this scale as much because it got a little bit obsessive and I wanted to get away from it. So I still encourage people to utilize it if they want to do the measurement tools.
Yeah.
But I also recommend for people to, do a video. So literally plant your phone, and we're gonna be actually doing a series on this. So you plant your phone, and then you literally just do a 360. And I always like flex. I hate fat shots, right? I want you to flex because I want to see what the changes in the muscle.
Yeah.
And so they do a 360 so you can get a full view of what's going on with your entire body.
Yeah.
So for men, you'd be in your like boxers,
yeah,
right? Like higher boxers, even briefs is better, so we can see your entire legs.
Yeah.
And then women's like a swimsuit, right? That's, you know, just the bra and just the shorts, because we want to see everything. So that would be the second measure. First measurement is this. Second measurement is the 360 shot.
Yeah.
And then fourth measurement is a piece of clothes. Mm-hmm. So for instance, for men, it could be a pair of jeans, right? Women, skinny jeans, right? Or even women have dresses. Men, belt size. You know what I mean? So those are like the three tools that you need to do. A legitimate scale, a video, so that it, or photos, but I like videos just because you can get the full 360 and it covers up so much time. And then is to go and find a couple pairs of something that you can use that as a remeasuring tool. Now when you're remeasuring, I tell people that you should remeasure every 4 weeks. Every week, if you're just getting going, to keep you motivated, because that first 30 days is always the hardest. So if you want to see progress in that first, but don't expect to keep doing that. For me, I maybe take a, you know, a measurement photo once a year, if that. You know what I mean? I don't, right? I know how I look. I know how my pants feel, you know, all that stuff. I've been doing this a very long time. My body fat is in and around the same, right? I'm happy with where I'm at, right? Now it's all about just performance for me. And so for anybody that's just getting going, then you should do that every 4 weeks. Don't get obsessive. And then if something was off, we have to go back. It's just like you as a doctor. Okay, so if somebody is having a heart condition and you measure that they have high LDLs, right? So low density lipoproteins. And then you like, okay, so we're going to try this med, right, with you. And so when you try the med, you'll be able to track as to whether it made improvements or whether it didn't. And so with the clients, you can't just go from month two to month three, and in between you're like, well, I've been doing everything. And it's like, well, what have you been doing? It'd be like me coming to you if I had high LDLs and saying, well, Marvin, I've been doing everything. I've been taking my pills every day. And then you're like, okay, well, how's your nutrition? And you're like, I'm like, it's good, man. Oh, what do you mean it's good? Well, you know, I eat McDonald's 3 days a week. It has lettuce in it. You know what I mean? And so it's like, well, what have you been tracking? You need to track everything that you're doing. So I know it's obsessive, but if you get so obsessive that every 4 weeks it puts you into this like depression because you didn't see major gains, then you need to track everything you do. How many hours of sleep? How many liters of water are you drinking? How many workouts did you do? Did you pre-plan your nutrition? Did you stick to your nutrition? Did you give it your all during your workouts? And if you can answer yes to all of those and you can show evidence to that, then me and you will sit down and I will write you out exactly and watch you every single day, right? That'd be like you putting me in incubation, right? And so that's the mindset that I want our clients and everybody out there watching to get across. So so basically subcutaneous fat is the fat that's sitting just kind of like just below the skin. I always call it the fresh fat. That's the fat that can often be manipulated. And then you're saying that the visceral fat is the deep fat that sits into the vital organs. And so that fat is the one that's the hardest to get rid of.
It's very hard to get rid of. And oftentimes, not only do you get, you know, the pot belly with that, as you age, the visceral fat gets worse because your metabolism is not as good. And if you battle with chronic diseases, like things like if you have high cholesterol or high blood pressure, you know, those things will contribute to more visceral fat in the body, right?
So let's go here. How do I get rid of it? So from a simplified standpoint, you can go on a medical standpoint, okay? So simplified is that you need to make sure that 50% of your plate is covered in dark leafy green vegetables. Then, and this is simplified, I'm not giving you macros, I'm not whatever. You want to eat a juicy steak, you can, but I want to see 50% of that plate is covered up in green leafy vegetables stacked above your food. So if your steak is that thick, then I need a double of that height in vegetables and covered, okay? And that's not even including your sauce. So I'm just, that's just greens. You eat that straight up, because I'm not giving you the allowance to put a bunch of greens on there. What do you got?
Well, you know what? The thing that I stress is, and I like simple is better. Is just, you just need to eat healthy, right? You need to eat healthy and you need to exercise, because the closer you are to healthy weight, and what I look at is a body mass index, if you're right in that sweet spot between 18.5 to 24.9, and that's something that they can measure here, then your visceral fat content is likely going to be at an ideal rate. You know, no fat, that's impossible. We need fat to live.
Of course.
But to get to a healthy weight, that almost that will coincide with how much visceral fat you're going to have.
So Marvin, you're the doctor that everybody, nurse practitioner, sorry, the professional that nobody wants to see because you're telling them the truth.
Yeah.
And so, but they want to know, is there a pill out there that they can take for this?
You know what? If you don't need a pill, if you can do it naturally, that's what I would promote. But there are. There are medications that can assist with weight loss and that can target certain types of cholesterol to lower it.
You know, so is that focused on weight loss or focused on visceral fat or body fat?
Well, a little bit of everything, right? Okay. Because you know, the medications are not really that selective. Like they don't just target visceral fat.
Oh.
They just make your body more efficient at removing excess fat. And so it'll target both.
What's excess? So what about if a lean guy like me took it?
Wouldn't need it.
But would it work?
You might, well, there's no fat in you to even get rid of.
I got some fat, Marvin.
I wouldn't recommend it.
So are you allowed to say what that prescription is or not?
Well, yeah, there's medications like it's called liraglutide or orlistat, and then cholesterol medications, you guys have heard it. Like
orlistat, I've seen commercials for that, no?
Yeah.
Does it cause leaky?
It can, yeah.
Okay, so,
I mean, there's always adverse
I've
effects,
I've seen that advertisement
right?
Where they're like, it may cause leaky butt syndrome.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So, you know, it's interesting, but we don't utilize it enough in Canada, but those weight loss medications, if you're really overweight and struggling, those are some medications that can absolutely
I always think that, especially for if you're just getting going, go and see someone like yourself, get your thyroid checked, get your blood work done, you know, and try working out, try clean eating, and if you're not seeing the progress that you know you should be getting, and you know that you should be getting it, I mean, you've been on it, then go and book an appointment with someone like yourself, and there could be something medically wrong with you,
absolutely.
Or not wrong, but something that could be medically enhanced, and then that's where your expertise comes in, because I can't talk about that stuff.
Yeah.
Like, I have an idea, but I couldn't give it to you even if I wanted to, so.
Yeah, and you know, just to add to that, you know, on the medical side, if you've noticed a change or if you haven't been feeling well and you want to drop weight, it's always a good idea to get a physical.
Yes.
Because one of the things that can contribute to weight gain is one, you know, if your thyroid's not functioning properly, if you have anemia, if you have diabetes, uncontrolled hypertension, all those things can contribute to it, because if you're getting into a weight loss program or you're starting to get exercise and you're not controlling those other things, it's really going to impair your ability to get good results. So,
yeah, I think that's so critical. So anybody that's really getting into it and they are like, they want to really seriously know and make some changes, then they should go and book a consult with you. Is it homehealthnp.com?
Yeah, homehealthnp. And so, we do home visits. We do virtual consults as well.
You even come to Fit Club.
And we come to Fit Club. Yeah, we can even draw blood work here now. So,
yes.
Yeah,
I've done it.
Yeah.
Other than that, let's wrap it up here. So for the non-prescriptive sides, couple things. Number one, usually when people come in here with a higher visceral fat, for instance, I had these two ladies come in and one has a history of working out, but it's been a couple of years since she worked out. The other has never worked out. They're the exact same height, same age, same body weight.
Yeah.
And the woman that has never worked out had the same body fat, they had the same look, but when they jumped on the scale, one had a high visceral fat, one had high body fat and very low muscle mass. Now, the other woman that took 2 or 3 years off for the gym, those were all down by at least 5%.
Okay.
And so you can see just by building up that reputation, even if it's been a couple months or year or decade since you last worked out, there's still something in your body and brain that has that memory, right? Like Michael Jordan, just because he hasn't played professional basketball in 10 years or whatever it is, he can still shoot a basket. Absolutely. And so the same thing with your body is your body knows what to do. It's just going to take some time and perseverance through the brain, through the mindset.
Yeah.
Now, when it comes to supplementations for this, and we'll wrap it up here, there's a supplement that I've done research on, and a couple different supplements. So the first supplement is called lipotropics, and the name says itself, right? Lipotropics emulsified, right? Mm-hmm. And so what they say is that it goes into the body fat, and inside the fat, there's like large particles of fat sitting within there. Mm-hmm. And then you have basically two sides to each fat cell. One side is where the mitochondria sit, right? So mitochondria is what, where your body demands and says, hey, I need energy.
Yeah.
The mitochondria go into the fat cell themselves. They pull the energy out, they release it to when your heart rate goes up and whenever you need kind of fuel source, right? Yeah. So as you get older, or as that visceral fat goes up, that fat now becomes like a solid glob, mm-hmm. versus like the new 18-year-old fat, that's kind of like that loose fluffy stuff,
yeah,
right? If you pinch their fat and you pinch somebody 30 years older than them, mm-hmm. and they got the same body fat, one is going to be more dense,
yeah,
right? If you go and pinch your Tito's fat, it's hard. Right?
Yeah.
So Tito is uncle, right? So like those guys with the big stomach, you go pinch that stomach is hard.
Yeah,
that's solidified that fat. That's the hard fat. That's that it's really hard to get rid of, right? And so this supplement actually goes in there and it breaks down and emulsifies the fat so that it goes from one big solid glob mm-hmm. down to small little particles. Mm-hmm. The other supplement I recommend and we sell here at Fit Club is L-carnitine. Mm-hmm. And so L-carnitine was made from grass-fed beef.
Yeah.
Okay. But you can't get it in a high enough content by just eating steak mm-hmm. from grass-fed beef. And so what they've done, they've extracted it out itself. And then there's a doorway, a gateway from the fat cells to the mitochondria. So that L-carnitine opens it up.
Okay.
Yeah. And then the third supplement is something like what we have here, which is a leaner. So any type of like metabolism booster.
Yeah.
So like cayenne pepper is one of them that's in there, right? Another kind of not so researched, but highly advertised, like through Dr. Oz, is Garcinia Cambogia. That's another like metabolism enhancer, caffeine. Mm-hmm. You recommended that on one of your posts recently,
yeah,
right? So
absolutely.
The caffeine also raises your metabolism.
Yes.
And so green coffee bean, it's got all of that in there. So when you work those three in conjunction, that's how you're going to be able to manipulate that body fat and drop that visceral fat in conjunction.
Yeah.
What does the word supplement mean, Marvin?
Yeah, in conjunction.
In
to
conjunction.
Add to
supplement to what you're doing, which should be number one, changing your lifestyle.
Yeah,
number two,
absolutely.
Working out consistently. Number three, then fix your nutrition. And I put nutrition after working out. You know why?
Why?
Because eating is related to everything we do.
Yeah.
If you're bored, what do?
Oh, you eat. Yeah.
If you're happy,
you eat.
You're sad?
You eat.
You eat.
Yeah.
So how can I change all that? I can't fix you right away. All I can do is I can say, let's work out for 30 days consistently.
Yeah.
Build that up, and then you're going to want to eat better
because
you're going to want to feel better for every workout, and you're going to want to start to see some better
Absolutely.
Results. So that's it. Coach RJ, my main man, Marvin of homehealthnp.com. I want to thank everybody for tuning in. If you got any value out of this, if you feel like there's something that we can do to help you with your this like just learning this stuff with your visceral fat, with your body fat, with your weight, with your goals, please throw us a like, comment saying that you loved it, or if you didn't, we'll take that comment as well. And also,
Absolutely.
Please share it onto your page. Let's get the word out. We'll see you next time.
Take care.